book, though, with Charlie, the men who fell in love with her didn't know what to do.
Well, the thing is the man who falls in love with her, that she has the baby from.
Was that Ed? No, the first man.
This is Byron, the runaway slave. She was living her life as a woman then. So, you know, it was a male, female, he knew. But later on, when she went to California, you know, she had a lot of women falling in love with her because she was like the rock star of, you know, stagecoach drivers were like rock stars of their time.
Yeah.
And so she had a lot of women after her.
Now, there's a chapter here I'd love to have you read for our friends in the audience.
Yes, I would love it. This is, you know, the thing about that's interesting is this book is also about forgiveness. And I just want to say one thing, and that is that I have a question, and I want you to think about it, and the audience. What would you do if someone destroyed horribly everything in your life and everyone and swallowed you whole? Could you forgive them? And we'll talk about that later if you want. And the reason is that what I'm going to read to you, this one page, is
from the start
from the book, yes. Yeah. It's right after her family's been destroyed. And she has on men's clothes. And she's riding through the town that she lived in. Her name was Charlotte before she changed it to Charlie. Charlotte rode down the main street of Providence, Byron's old hat pulled low over her forehead. She rode past Mrs. Bidwell's boarding house and the bookstore. She rode past Bronson's general store. Mr. Bronson was opening the shutters of the horse and its rider. He noticed nothing out of the ordinary. He glanced up at the click-clocking, and then his eyes slid back to his hands fastening the shutters. The horse had looked inconsequential. The rider had looked inconsequential. The hooves clopped in the usual way. She tried to take this all in. That the woman in her had died in anguish and a vengeful man had been born in her place apparently brooked no notice of the universe. Nor had the universe even blinked in the absorption into itself of her tragedy. It was astonishing to her that the sun had re-risen and shone down on them all in the same way as always before, that the townspeople weren't transfixed in shock, dumbfounded, changed outright at the death of the old world and the hollow, hopeless replacement offered in exchange. But no, their lives seemed to be moving on as usual. Charlotte looked around her in dismay. The townspeople were, all of them, just the same as any other day. How could that be? She rode on past the crumbling brick buildings and the peeling white houses. Everything was temporary. She understood that now. All of this was temporary. It would be snatched away. It was all on loan. Even the people we love, they were all on loan. One day you see their face across a rickety table. You pass them hurrying from here to there, you see them leave you in your bed, and their profile passes you by, and you don't know. Your thoughts somewhere else, and then they're snatched away forever, and you did not know to say goodbye. You did not know. It was going to be a bracing autumn day. The leaves were glimmering in the early light. They'd been turning crisp in the cold night and rattled now with the breeze. They were orange, gold, and red. In her old life, she might have called it glorious, but now she knew the truth about all this beauty.
Temporary, temporary, and no one knows, or as the line goes, make God laugh, tell him your plans.
That's right. You know, I believe that in every problem, there's a gift in its hand, and we create the problem because we need the gift?
Well, possibly it. I mean, I'm just thinking because, as I said to you, I was in Sandy, the storm, and it is a frightening thing to suddenly have no control.
Yes, that's exactly right. And when, you know, we were talking about, also I wanted to ask you the question about forgiveness. Could you forgive someone who did that to you?
No.
No.
No. I am not a I am an understanding but not forgiving.
Now, I have to tell you the truth. If someone destroyed my mama and my daddy, or if I had children, yeah, or whatever, horribly, like, do you remember those two monsters in Connecticut who...
Oh, yes, who shot the doctor's wife and two daughters.
They tied them to the bed. They raped all three of the wife and the two girls and burnt them in their bed.
Yeah, I mean...
Now, they asked the doctor later, could he forgive them? And he said, I do not forgive evil.
Yeah, yeah. Now, I'm not for the death penalty, but then I'm not for life for somebody who does that.
Yeah, and this book mainly is about, yeah, she deals with for this forgiveness, yeah, thing, because the person who kills her husband, yeah, is someone she knows.
How did you decide where you would end the book?
It's funny, before we talked, I mean, before we started,
yeah,
I was telling you that it took me so long to find the ending.
Yeah.
I couldn't get it. I just couldn't. Yeah. I would think, and it would keep me up at night. Finally, one day, yeah, I was just staring into space, not thinking of anything, and suddenly the ending came to me.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, when you're really trying, it's like trying to remember someone's name, you know?
Relax.
Relax, and yeah, then eventually, hopefully, it comes.
And you say she's buried in the odd...
She's buried in Watsonville, California, yeah, in the Pioneer Odd Fellows Cemetery.
Yeah.
And you know what the Odd Fellows were?
They were like the Masons.
Yes, you're, yeah, exactly right. Look, yeah, at you. My God, you're smart.
Oh, thank
well,
you.
Well, very few people know that.
Yeah, well... If you look into the history of California, they were part of the Albany Regulars who came out to keep California from the so-called Chileanos.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, that's
and
interesting.
And that was probably the first sort of organization of the Eastern men who came to California.
Well, the interesting thing is that only, as you say, only men could belong,
yeah,
and they asked Charlie to join. So she's the only woman.
Yeah, but they didn't know.
They didn't know, but
yeah,
because she did so many good deeds. She was,
yeah,
a good person.
Home became what, Watsonville?
Watsonville, yes.
Yeah.
And in fact, if you visit Watsonville, after you see her grave, which,
yeah,
I've done many times, you can go up this road, Freedom Road, and her... The house is not there anymore, but,
yeah,
there's a place where she lived. You can find it if you're interested.
What will the next book be?
I'm writing a book called Looking for Jack Kerouac.
Yeah.
And it's, well, you know, I've had a very interesting life. I've almost died twice. I've almost been killed once. I was very fortunate and dated King Hussein of Jordan when I was in England. Lex Barker. Who was Tarzan in the movies,
he was my
fiancé, and he dropped dead when we were in New York. In fact, I wrote that chapter that I just read for you out of the feelings about losing Lex. He was only 3 days after his 54th birthday. I was much younger, of course. But I've had this really interesting life. And
did you know his sister, Freddie?
No, I didn't.
She lived out here in California.
No.
Yeah.
I'm not sure. I think she was maybe, you know, his family died. His son just passed away, Zen,
yeah,
about a month ago. His young son, who was named after him. He's not young anymore. He was 65, I guess.
Yeah.
But anyway, I've had this life. So I, talking about the book, is I'm going to write about my life, but I'm going to fictionalize it. And it's not that my life was that interesting. What I want to say is this. That all of us, you know how sometimes we don't get what we desire and sometimes we realize we were protected because we didn't get it?
Mm-hmm.
That's, my life has been like that.
Yeah.
Over and over again.
Well, as it was written by Frost, two roads diverge in a yellow wood, and I took the one less traveled by. And I'm going to ask you, will you autograph my book?
I would love it.
You'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.conniemartinson.com. and support your local library. That is our finest democratic institution in America. Because whatever you are, libraries will help you, A, learn to read. If you have trouble reading because of eye problems, they will have large print books there. And they will also have computers, because libraries are moving into the 21st, 22nd generation. And librarians are the greatest help, unsung heroines and heroes in our country. Now, a couple of books you might like. Ned Vizzini's book, The Other Normal. Young boy goes off to camp, 15 years old. I love the fact, parents are divorced. Each has taken one of the lawyers from the divorce and has married them. So the mother has a legal male attorney, and the husband has the woman attorney who had handled his case. And he refers to them as the lawyers. But this is a book about their sending him off to camp to become a man, to be masculine. And he, at camp, discovers, because he's a kid who has played like, oh, all of those games where you take a different personality, he finds another world that he calls the other normals. Interesting book. Now, what did a library mean to you growing up in Boston?
Oh, well, I left when I was very young, but I learned to love books and write out of libraries.
Well, support your library, and whatever you do, help them where you can, and we'll see you next time. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I just wanted to say that the book is also an audio book.